welcome to the show. Well, it appears Trump has made a miraculous recovery.
Trump's back on the campaign trail in front of a packed crowd in Florida with few masks in sight.
His doctors claim he has a clean bill of health.
Maybe I'm immune, I don't know.
No, you don't. One thing we do know, he has been hitting the drugs hard.
He is now on dexamethasone, which, as anyone who's been on a steroid can tell you, causes mania, causes psychosis.
Which is science for he's off his tits. Listen to his message for pensioners.
You're not vulnerable, but they like to say the vulnerable, but you're the least vulnerable. But for this one thing, you are vulnerable.
You're not vulnerable. You're vulnerable. And they think that makes you vulnerable, and that's why they are vulnerable. Oh, God, Tom, it's really good! The drugs, they haven't just messed with his head. Look what they did to his skin. He's gone from this to this. Look at it. He's like he's been covered in Dorito dust. Of course, even the girls on tower would be like, I think you've overdone the bronzer, babe. And yet Trump has the temerity to say this.
I'm back because I'm a perfect physical specimen.
Perfect physical specimen? Yeah, if that specimen's a clinically obese Satsuma. It's nuts. Nobody is walking into a plastic surgeon's asking for the Trump. I want tiny hands, man boobs, and lips like a cat's anus. Doctor! Doctor, I want a face that makes vaginas gip. So... favourite joke of the show. So, at Trump's rallies, is he wearing a mask? Is he social distancing? No! He's offering to do this.
I'll walk in there, I'll kiss everyone in that audience. I'll kiss the guys and the beautiful women and the... everybody, I'll just give you a big fat kiss.
I'll lick the women. I'll sneeze on the babies. I'll lick your granddad's nooksack. I don't know what that was about. I was really grinding into that. But when he wasn't infecting his own voters, he wouldn't stop banging on about one particular drug he took.
They gave me Regeneron.
Well, I took the Regeneron.
Regeneron.
We have Regeneron.
Regeneron.
It's called Regeneron.
Why is he promoting that? Could it have anything to do with the fact that the president had stakes in Regeneron? Jesus, I'm surprised he didn't make an advert.
Are you suffering from coughing, high temperatures, anxiety about the future? Maybe it's time to try Regeneron, a totally unproven cure for COVID-19. But don't listen to me. Listen to this unbiased expert.
You know, I wasn't feeling so hot, and within a very short period of time, they gave me Regeneron.
It's an antibody drug. You take it, and it beats the hell out of it.
You're gonna get better. You're gonna get better really fast.
Try the new, totally unproven cure for COVID-19, endorsed by a president who had shares in our company. Side effects may include slurred speech.
Cephalide.
Inability to pronounce countries.
And Tanzania.
And hatred of insects.
I don't like mosquitoes.
Who does? Regeneron. It's better than science.
It sounded so great, I've actually got some. Let's see whether it's any good, shall we? Pop this down here. I feel great. I feel like a perfect physical specimen. What is it with Trump pushing drugs? Remember the start of the pandemic when he was trying to flog this?
Hydroxychloroquine.
Try it.
Hydroxychloroquine.
What do you have to lose?
Your life? Trump's advisor, Dr. Fauci, one of the world's leading experts on infectious diseases, said this.
Hydroxychloroquine is not effective in treating coronavirus disease or COVID-19.
Which is science for shut the fuck up. Poor old Fauci. Every time he's near Trump, you can tell his brain's melting.
I happen to feel good about it, but who knows? I've been right a lot. Let's see what happens, John. A very low incidence of death.
Now, it wasn't just Trump. Vice President Mike, I call my wife mother, Pence, was in the news debating Kamala Harris. Fair to say, it didn't go great.
This debate had none of the histrionics and shouting of last week in what felt like a nil-all draw. To be honest, the most exciting bit came when a very black fly landed in Mike Pence's very white hair.
That was the highlight. Doesn't say much for the debate, does it? What are they saying on Twitter? He's got a fly on his head. What else? That's it, Mike. That's it. Now, maybe it landed on him because Pence was talking so much shit, the fly mistook him for a turd. Listen to what he was saying when the fly landed.
And that is, Joe Biden said that he believes that law enforcement has an implicit bias against minorities is a great insult.
He implied American police don't have a bias against black people. If you listen carefully, the fly gives him a gentle heckle.
President Trump and I stand with you.
Oh, shut up, you cunt!
Do you know what caught my attention? The attack ads against Joe Biden. They've accused him of being China's bitch. Increasing granny bashing.
To answer your emergency call, but leave a message and we'll get back to you as soon as we can.
Crime will rise.
And feeding on journalists like a hungry zombie. So, how did the Democrats hit back? Did they attack Trump for racism, sexism, corruption? No! They went for this.
How would I look walking a dog on the White House lawn with that?
Is that? Yeah, that'll bring him down, won't it? He's just being a dog lover doesn't mean you're a good person, right, Adolf? I mean, there are many, many examples that prove that. It's mad. What other animal accusations are they going to sling at him? Trump once called a horse a wanker. Trump thinks ducks are sluts. Trump once dunked his balls in a bird bath.
Don't worry, don't worry. I'm immune. Don't worry. I'm the perfect physical specimen.
What the fuck's going on? It's that bloke on the telly, he's rubbing his balls in my bird bath.
Just go with it. Just go with it.
Regeneron, what, mate? Now, back in Britain, it looks like we are in for a long winter.
Boris Johnson announces tough new local coronavirus rules in England.
The Liverpool City region is the first to go into the toughest band, with no socialising and pubs and bars to close.
Christ, the hospitality sector is in tatters. Job losses, businesses going under. I mean, have you seen what pubs in Scotland are having to do?
Pubs, restaurants and cafes will only be able to open indoors from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. No alcohol at all will be allowed.
Pubs with no booze? Come on, guys, the lemonades are on me! Oh, did somebody spill my latte? It's just not the same. Pubs without alcohol is like... it's like the national anthem sung without fans. Fucking awful.
Oh.
what's frustrating for places like Liverpool, if the government had a decent test and trace system, we wouldn't be in this mess. I mean, have you heard the latest cock-up?
The number of people with coronavirus in England is 16,000 higher than it was previously reported because of a technical glitch.
And what was that technical glitch? Bots? Russian hackers? No. The Excel spreadsheet containing lab results reached this maximum size. I've run out of rows. Apparently, the Microsoft paperclip was livid.
What an absolute shower of shit.
But don't worry, Boris Johnson is back and he's got a new catchphrase that doesn't make any sense.
We need to behave fearlessly but with common sense.
How can you have common sense and be fearless? Come on, Britain, swim with sharks, but make sure they've eaten. He's such a joke. Did you see him at the Tory party conference attacking people that don't believe in wind power?
I remember how some people used to sneer at wind power 20 years ago and say it wouldn't pull the skin off a rice pudding.
Right? Who would say something like that? Wind farms couldn't pull the skin off a rice pudding, says Boris Johnson. He's arguing with himself. Surely he must have known that he said that, because no one else judges energy through fucking puddings. PM, we've got a new wind turbine. Excellent. Can it destroy an apple crumble? Can it exterminate a trifle? Can it bitch slap a banoffee pie? Arguing with something he said. Who else is he going to have a pop at? People who can't use zip wires? Men that twat Japanese children? People who listen to music through their eyes? He's such a useless tosser. Oh, and in case you're wondering... Join me after break where I'll be asking your questions to the stars of Taskmaster, Greg Davies and Alex Horne. Hey, welcome back to the show. This week on Life Lessons, I ask the question, what's your weird obsession?
My weird obsession, yeah, is that in year six, I used to fancy Cilla Black. You know, the Liverpool lady with the big teeth. I don't know, she just used to do it for me, man. A lot of laughs on that. Oh.
Watching rollerbladers dance on their blades, like, it's just so cool. And the thing is, I can't rollerblade. I'm terrible at it. I've got no hand-foot-elbow coordination. But they look so cool doing it, and I can watch them do it all day. I love it.
Listen, not only was Cilla a painting now, yeah? She was a thug in the boardroom as well. Apparently, I heard a story now where if you had a meeting with Cilla Black, okay, she had a glass of Prosecco, and by the time she finished that glass of Prosecco, you had to get your asses out of the meeting finished. Thug and sexy.
I've watched now into, honestly, like 700 episodes of Real Housewives, and it's gotten to the point where I watch so much Real Housewives that in real life, and this is a bit of a weird time to actually be realizing this, I always think they're gonna cut to me on a camera talking about my feelings about what happened the day before.
I have a weird obsession with bursting spots. I like watching them be popped. YouTube particularly, Dr. Pimple Popper's a personal favorite, but there's many others. I'm talking blackheads, whiteheads, cysts. Superficial cysts, any sort of spot, I'll take it, you know? Basically, if you look at my internet history, and please don't, it looks like I think YouTube was invented to look at spots being burst.
My weird obsession is my neighbour Mark. I just really want to know where he works. Where do I think Mark works? I would say somewhere he's earning. It'll be an office.
My weird obsession
is, drum roll please, has to be salmon. I'm being so serious. Like, salmon is everything to me. If you see how I talk about salmon, you'd want your potential bae to talk about you like that. The way I look at salmon, the way I eat salmon, I take it slow. The way I cook salmon, I make sure I marinate it with my fingers. I talk to the fish. You have to talk to your food because it's going into you, so you gotta make sure the food is good energy, good vibes. You know what I'm talking about? Salmon is my world.
My weird obsession is that people are talking about chips going into COVID vaccines. Like we need to follow what some of these dumb bastards are doing in life. No one gives a shit what Dave in Dagenham is doing on a day-to-day basis. Take the vaccine and shut the fuck up.
Now it's time for your questions, where I book the guests, but the questions are up to you. This week, I was joined by the stars of Taskmaster, Greg Davies and Alex Horne.
Ah! Back with a bang! Little Alex Horne!
Yeah, big boy. Oh! Oh!
Make the largest object properly vanish.
Greg, Alex, thanks very much for being on the show.
Hello, Russell. Thanks for having us.
Also, hello, Russell.
Greg, those headphones make you look a lot like a gamer.
Yeah, I know. Maybe I am a gamer.
He's not a gamer.
First question, listen to this.
If they could pick anyone anywhere to be a contestant on a series of Taskmaster, who would they pick and why?
It's a good question. It's a very good question.
It is Benito question. Mussolini.
Yeah. So you have Emma Slooney, I'll have Ken Dodd, and I guess we just see what happens. Put them as a team.
I mean, it's a great start. It's a great start. You just need three more contestants.
It's quite male heavy at the moment.
yeah, you get Eva Braun.
Yeah. The Crankies?
We'll have the Crankies and Rosa Park, and we got us a series.
We're in.
Right, what's the next question?
So, the question I have is something that's been playing my mind for the longest time. The dynamic that Greg and Alex have on the show Taskmaster, is that like an abusive father and his feeble son, or is it a BDSM lover relationship? I would love some clarification. Thank you so much. Love you guys.
And those are the two options, are they?
Apparently those are the two options. That's what she was getting from feeble sum or bondage, what we're dealing with.
If you go onto Reddit, as I discovered, much to my horror recently, there is an awful lot of sexual fiction about Alex and I, imagining Alex and I as lovers.
Yeah, I'm going to have to read all of that tonight.
I mean, I got through two stories and thought, no, it's... It's really making me unhappy.
You got through two stories.
You read the first one. You read the first one and you went, well, they probably won't all be like this. I'll have one more. Oh no, I'm doing it again.
I don't think it's very sexual from my point of view, but there might be a bit some daddy issues.
The thing that struck me about those stories I can't take the sexual chemistry between Alex and I seriously because I haven't got the energy that the writers of those stories imagine I have. So for me, it's more of a a stern father and son relationship. I feel like I'm helping him by giving him boundaries. But just to be absolutely crystal clear, I don't want to fuck him.
And how do you feel, Alex? Do you feel like he's a sort of a domineering father? Or do you feel like secretly he wants to plough you?
I mean, without any offence, I think it's more grandfatherly in terms of... Just the way I feel. He makes me feel such a little boy that I feel there's at least two generations between us.
Let's have another question. This is for Greg. I wonder if he could clear up a question for me. My sister's always said Greg came to a party I threw at my mum's cottage on Whitmere Lake, Ellesmere, Shropshire, late 80s. As this is my only claim to fame, it would be nice to have it corroborated. Greg, did you go to a party at someone's mum's cottage in Shropshire in the 80s?
I I definitely did. And I've got so many stories about that party. I wouldn't know where to start. I could do a monologue, and I'm going to cherry pick one of the stories. They put tents out, big tents for us all to sleep in. Yeah. And me and my friend Belle decided we'd had enough at 2 o'clock in the morning, and we went into one of the big tents to go to sleep. Okay. And within seconds of us being in there, our other friend with his new Danish girlfriend came in and lay between us with her, and they started to have violently loud sexual intercourse while shouting at each other in Danish. I was within 3 inches of two people shouting sexual things at each other in Danish whilst pounding it. It was excruciating.
But I don't understand, but surely, you know, it's fairly obvious that you're 6'7", you're led in a tent. Like, did they know you were there?
They did when we started laughing. I'd love to know what was being said, because it was so aggressive from both of them.
Here's another question from Florence Foster. What was your weirdest lockdown moment? And was there a time that you stepped back for a second and thought, what the fuck is going on?
I had to sing a duet with Robbie Williams over Zoom because he was bored and we share a saxophonist. And he said, can you keep Robbie entertained for an evening? So we sang Angels together over Zoom.
Wow, that is an extraordinary moment.
Mm. He was over in America and I was in England, 2 o'clock in the morning. And all my family were asleep during the performance.
So Robbie Williams was bored in a hotel and he wanted to sing Angels with Alex Horne. I mean, I don't want to be crude, but surely just have a wank, Robbie.
Do you know what I mean?
Why? Well, like, I've got to ring up Alex Horne and sing Angels. It's the only way I can get through this boredom. I mean
there's a chance he did both. The screen was cut off at the bottom.
That is extraordinary. Did you record it? Is there
evidence? Yeah, I recorded it. And weirdly, it was... Well, not weirdly, it was really exciting, Russell. It's Robbie Williams.
Yeah, of course, exactly. I'm loving angels instead. Greg, has Dolly Parton ever rang you up at 3 a.m, gone, do you want to do 9 to 5 with me? I doubt it.
I feel like Alex has ruined it, really. I mean, what can I say about that's going to be interesting for my weird lockdown moment that beats doing an online duet with Robbie Williams? There's nothing, I've got nothing to follow it with. I'll tell you the truth. I guess my weirdest lockdown moment is my inflatable jacuzzi burst and I flooded the flat of some old people below me.
Were you in it when it popped?
Weirdly, I wasn't, but I suspect that the fact that I have been in it multiple times is what put the strain on the seams of it. I'll tell you what my friend Rich said pre-lockdown, when him and I were sitting in the inflatable jacuzzi on my balcony looking out over London. We had a glass of wine in our hands and... he turned to me and he said, mate, kings have lived and died and not experienced this luxury.
This is a lovely one. It says, what was the highlight from doing the home tasking? Which was fantastic, by the way. But what was your highlight?
I mean, my highlight was when things appeared on the news in other countries. So there was some American local telly report because two brothers had won one of the tasks by throwing a basketball in some trousers over a house into a hoop. And that's such a weird rippling effect. You know, you set one little task and it ends up on the news in Arkansas.
Wow, so did they interview? We're here with, like, local celebrities of the one. Was it that kind of thing?
It was more in the studio. What I loved about it, it was like the two regional news anchors talking about, there's this show in the UK called Taskmaster.
This is from Red December. A question for little Alex Horne. How does it feel to sit on a cake with your bare ass? And did some of it get into you?
Well, Red December, it's a sensation which I've yet to repeat, but not because I don't want to. It was one of the most pleasing sensations I've ever had. A lot of icing went inside me.
It went into you?
It got sucked up, Greg. It had nowhere else to go.
OK.
Right, this is a great question. Listen to this.
Name your celebrity crush. Second part of the question. If your celebrity crush and your mum swap bodies, and the only way to change him back was to shag one of them, which one would you shag?
Well, there you go. There you go.
What?
So either you're shagging your mum's body with the other person's head, or your mum's head with the other person's body.
But we, just to be clear, in whichever scenario we go with, we have to have sex with part of our mums.
It would appear so.
I mean, I'm happy to say Carol Vorderman.
Is she your crush?
Well, she was when I used to watch it when I was 18. And I'm happy to cling on to my... I don't think you ever let go of your crush, do you?
Wow. So you just gave up on crushes 20 years ago, Alex. That was it. You met your wife, you went, done. No more of this malarkey.
My long-term crush was Joanne Whalley, but Joanne Whalley hasn't done much lately, has she?
Who's Jo? I don't know. Joanne Whalley.
Joanne Whalley. She's Val Kilmer's ex-wife.
Right. Wow. Unbelievably specific.
It's not the last time. She's an actor in her own right. But
yeah, I mean, sure, but you...
She was a long-term crush. Do I want to have sex with her with my mum's body attached to her head? No.
I think the question was, you have to do it to set them free again or something. So I think I'm happy not to.
So your mum's going to walk around with Vorderman's body, Alex, and you don't think that's going to trouble you?
It's not as much as me doing what that man is insisting I do with it.
True.
And I haven't seen Joanne Whalley for ages, and... So I'm more than happy for Joanne Whalley to have my mum's boss.
Right, next question.
Hi, Alex and Greg. This is my goat, Greg. And he'll do anything for a chocolate hobnob. So what is the one thing that you'll do anything for without question? Thanks. Bye.
There you think. What's the one thing you would do anything for without question?
Oh, without wishing to be unimaginative, a chocolate hobnob.
I'm £2,000.
Well, I'll be putting that to the test soon.
Right, who's next?
Hey!
Hi, Alex. Hi, Greg. Big fan. My question is, what's your favourite noise?
There you go. What is your favourite noise?
Why does she whisper so much, Russell?
I think she recorded that next to my dad working and he was on a Zoom chat. So she sent me a text that I had to be quite quiet because your dad was working.
It sounded like she was auditioning to be the new Cadbury's Caramel.
Oh, God, that'd be an awful image. My mum is that Cadbury's bunny. Good Lord.
You know what I like, Russell, noise-wise, because I heard it recently. I was watching diving videos from old Olympics. And the moment when it's a really good dive and it hardly breaks the surface at all, and then there's a moment of silence just before the audience start roaring with appreciation, that little gap between the splash and the cheer, that's my favourite noise.
Oh, yeah, that's an excellent answer.
Lovely.
Greg.
Yeah, I can't beat that. I've bought some giant ice cube trays for when I'm... drinking spirits, Russell, and they make giant ice cubes that virtually fill the glass. And when I put the chosen spirit onto the giant ice cube, it always cracks in a sort of way. I like that noise.
Yeah. Two great answers.
My favourite is, briefly, Johnny Depp was living in Bath and you could see him occasionally walking around, and the noise that old ladies made when they encountered Depp in the street. Oh, just that, always like a fainting goat, you know that? Just really small. Something about a sort of a 65-year-old woman being sort of sexually aroused by a Hollywood A-lister. For me, that's my favourite.
Your favourite noise is the noise of old women being turned on.
Being surprised that they're turned on in the street, specifically. But, yeah.
Cool. Yeah, I'm cool with that, too. I'm cool with that.
Yeah. Or three very different answers. That was so ace. Fellas, thank you very much. Best of luck with the new
Thanks
series.
Thanks for having us.
Take care. See ya.
Thanks, mate.
Thanks,
bye.
Bye.
Join me after the break, and I'll be chatting to the brilliant James Bay. Welcome back. My guest this week is one of Britain's finest singer-songwriters.
James Bay is a singer-songwriter who earned massive success in 2015 with his Grammy-nominated debut album, Chaos and the Calm. Hold back the river, let me look in your eyes. Hold back the river so high. Since then, he's gone on to win 2 Brit Awards, released the hit follow-up album, Electric Light, and now he's gearing up for his worldwide virtual gig live at Shakespeare's Globe.
Please welcome James Bay!
Here we are. Oh, I'm losing papers.
Ah, oh, already. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
The last time I saw you, we'd just done a gig, and it was like you'd had 15 Red Bulls and 17 ounces of cocaine. Because, I should explain to everybody, I've got a little gig in Clapham, and James came along and did it, and you hadn't performed this year?
I hadn't performed to a crowd since it was the middle of September, I can't remember the date, but 2019.
Yeah.
But I was just like, inside, I was like, oh my, it's been so long.
Yeah.
And, like, thinking all those things.
But that was what was so spellbinding about it, was to see someone so talented be a little bit nervous, wander on stage, and then the first clang of the guitar, everyone went, and you literally went, yes, I am! And it was, you suddenly, it was like you remembered who you were. It was like watching a superhero that hadn't put his cape on. Like that, well, and suddenly you were caped up and you were fucking smooth. But watching it, it was so fascinating to see.
Yeah, I was just desperate to be in front of a crowd because it's just the most incredible, magical, like, undescribable experience, as you know. Because it's been, like I say, it's been just over a year that I did my last show. What I sort of didn't realise would be my last gig for so long. And that was a special one. I was invited by a guitar hero of mine, Eric Clapton. He holds a charity concert every few years. They're like these all-star guitar legend shows. And he invited me, he said, you know, we'd love for you to be a part of it. So I went along. Most incredible weekend of my life. There's all these, like, superstar guitar players. Bill Murray is the compere.
Oh.
There's a whole thing, like, for me about just Bill Murray. I was just this little kid who was obsessed. One of the first movies I sort of remember being in love with and terrified by was Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
And Bill Murray, like, announced me on stage. We do our thing.
This,
like,
is you. And, look at this, is you and there Bill together. What a great photo.
What a great hat.
What is he like? He strikes me as somebody that would never let you down.
He doesn't let you down.
Yeah.
I mean, he says, he's like, he's kind of reading off a sheet, because we hadn't met at the point that I was, like, walking on stage.
Yeah.
And he's been announcing everybody on. And he said some really nice stuff. And later on, I was watching somebody else on stage, and he just kind of came by and did the sort of initial, all right, mate, that was great. Like, good for you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Good for you, sort of, you know, young kid amongst all these legends.
Yeah.
But he sort of stopped. And Lucy was with me, my girlfriend was with me, and we were just like, you know, just sort of like freaking out, holding tight to each other. It's Bill Murray, it's Peter Venkman.
Yeah.
It's a Ghostbuster. He's saying really nice things. And he's still standing here, and he's still saying nice things. And then we sort of managed to sort of drop our shoulders and sort of breathe, and he just was the best bloke in the world.
There's so many amazing stories. It's a really great story that Bill Murray likes going up to people in New York, tapping them on the shoulder, spinning them around and going, rah! And then they go like that, and he says, nobody will ever believe you. And then kind of walks away, and you hear so many great stories about him. He's kind of like this legend.
Yeah, and without the photo, I would expect you not to believe me, it's okay. But, you know, think about that high.
Yeah.
Not knowing that it's going to be over a year until I get to do anything close to that again.
Yeah.
So, like, the energy when you said so casually, just come do a set.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, yeah, sure, I'll
but
do it.
But it was.
Be great.
But it was, what I found so fascinating is I've seen you in a stadium in Barcelona.
Mm.
I've seen you in a stadium I've seen you at Twickenham supporting the Rolling Stones. It was so funny, that gig, honestly. There was this moment where Mick Jagger came out and just went, yeah, who got the 283 from Teddington? Like that. The fucking whole crowd was like, what? He went, yeah, that bus was all right. We fell on it once, didn't we, Keith? I just found that so funny. What's it like? What's it like to play a stadium with the Stones? What is that like?
It's kind of funny. It's kind of ridiculous. So I'm a massive Rolling Stones fan.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so many people are. to be on that stage in front of that crowd. Like, the crowd are a bigger deal than any support act at a Rolling Stones show.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Full shivers. Yeah, well, the greatest moment.
The whole gig was just amazing. You've had so many moments with, like, heroes. Mm. Like, I remember me and my brother met David Gray when I was 12 and Daniel was 10. And I was a huge fan of his, and I just was stunned, couldn't say anything. Sure. He just walked past us at Old Trafford. It was mad. Ugh. And my brother's, like, 10, not even a fan of David Gray, but marches up to him and goes, David! Put his hand out and went, cracking musician. He took his hand. It was this bizarre moment where David Gray sort of shakes this child's hand and he goes, keep it up. That and kind of walked off. And it's, I really want to meet David Gray so I can kind of go, do you ever remember that moment at Old Trafford? He's like, fucking hell. Because I bet he would.
Sure.
Just that moment when a tiny ginger boy went, keep it up, son. We're talking about performing. We should chat about this. You've got a new gig, which is very exciting.
Yes. Yeah.
You can explain it. It takes place at Shakespeare's Globe, doesn't it? And it's a live gig.
It is a live gig, but it's sort of not a live gig like any of us want it to be. There's no crowd. I'm trying to reach people all around the world. So you can buy tickets now to this show and watch it from anywhere in the world. And it's a Shakespeare's Globe, which is sort of, I don't know, one of the most sort of historically, like, legendary performance spaces, which is a very exciting thing.
When is that out?
It's on the 21st of October.
Cool.
And, like, it's the Globe. It's kind of got all these different sort of dimensions about it, and it's amazing history, and, like, it's very much a home to acting. I am not an actor. So I'm excited to sort of bring some music to the space, and I'm going to try, short of kneeling with a skull, I'm going to, in a sort of Shakespeare way, I'm going to try and sort of bring... I'm going to try and sort of nod towards the space that we're in.
Oh,
and,
nice.
Like, reinterpret some of my stuff for this special show and do some stuff I haven't sort of done before. That's all I'll say.
And how can people watch it?
You buy a ticket. You can go online and you get a link and you get cosy on the sofa, get it on the big screen and go for it. And, you know, cheer as loud as you can.
Because we know each other very well, I sort of feel like I know everything. But I read up about you, and I didn't know this.
Have you Googled me?
I Googled you, which is weird to Google a mate. and we have something in common.
What we got?
We both started out as trolley boys.
Yeah.
I didn't know you were a trolley boy.
Yeah.
What was your patch? what was your beat?
Sainsbury's and Hitchin.
Oh, Tesco Thornbury. Here's a question. Do you now, when you see trolleys left out...
Shudder.
Shudder.
Yeah.
Do you put them back? Do you put them away out of respect for the trolley boy you used to be?
The only reason I don't... And
you son of a bitch!
Hang on, hang on, hang on. The only reason
why don't you just take a shit in your 15-year-old self's mouth?
I had to push those days... far behind me.
So you don't even go near the trolley?
My car park,
yeah.
For my experience, on my patch,
yeah, yeah.
Whole thing was uphill.
Right.
All the trolleys, I'm scarred. All the trolleys, I just have nightmares regularly about these trolleys just rolling, and I've got to chase them to the bottom, and it's endless, and it's enough, I've got to get it back up there. But that was my experience.
What was the most you ever got in a row? How many did you get?
This is where it gets really
confusing. Yeah.
I don't know, 10 or 15.
Oh, okay, that's better than me.
What?
Yeah, me and the Tesco crew got an 8-ball going once.
I think I exaggerate with the 15. It was probably closer to 12. Definitely, I did a 10.
We had an 8, and we hit a car. Do you know what I mean? What was your lowest moment when you were working on the trolleys? Do you want me to go first, or do you want to go?
No, you go first.
My lowest moment was I was so hungry and I had no money that somebody had left some poppadoms in a trolley. And I ate those poppadoms from the trolley, but they were the poppadoms that you had to cook in the oven. So they were unripened poppadoms, and I still ate them. Age 21.
I never went that. I don't know if I sort of got to that place. I not so much my lowest moment as just my weirdest moment. Is a guy drove in, this like Hagrid man from Harry Potter, so yeah. It looked very similar, drove in this tiny car, and this was my last day. The reason I remember this is my last day. Pushing the trolleys. And he drove in quickly and turned into a space. But there was something in the front grille of his car.
Yeah.
And he got out, he looked like a farmer, and I thought, he's kind of come from, like, the sticks there. He's come from the countryside into the little town centre. And an old lady sort of came up to him and said, ah, in the front of your car, he went to the front of the car, there was a pheasant, like, hanging in the front of his car, like, neck head in the grill, body hanging out. Pulled it out and it was still alive.
Oh my God.
He went, it'll be all right, I'll get it out, I'll get it out, I'll get it out. He pulled it out carefully, carefully. Pulled it out. And the old lady was just sort of stood there looking on. Pulled it out, checking it out. And it sort of was twitching. So he just went bang on the bonnet of his car. Killed it. He said, I'll have that for dinner.
Wow.
And walked up into
what, and then he did he not go in there like, I don't know why I've come here. I've got the two.
Like that. Just walked off.
He went and got some sauces.
That. Yeah, so you got anything that will go with recently deceased livestock? What a fucking great story. So there's a gig you can watch. The album will be out next year.
The album is coming. But yeah, in the meantime, there's me and the band live at the Globe, 21st of October. I'm super excited.
Brilliant. Ladies and gentlemen, the fantastic James Bay! Finally tonight, it's Good Deeds, and it's all about a charity that combines mental health and bees.
Hi, I'm Ali. I started Bees Are Refugees. Bees Are Refugees offers beekeeping as therapy to refugees and local communities. I grew up in Syria. My father ran a knitwear factory. I ended up studying fashion design to support and help improve the business. We had a very nice, normal life. Well, until that changed in 2011. The Arab Spring started and the regime sent the army to the streets and they started shooting on people. My family got involved in supporting a couple of cities that were besieged by the army, and that led to the government burning down our factories and our home. We were left with nothing, basically. I got a job offer in Egypt, and it was like literally carrying my bag and leaving the next day. I spent almost a year there until they started arresting any Syrian who was wanted by the Syrian government, and they were sending them back to Syria. I was arrested. Luckily, I was granted asylum in the UK. I got a job in Harrods while also I was volunteering in refugee camps at the same time. Seeing both extreme worlds affected my mental health dramatically. I needed a way out eventually, and I found that in beekeeping. My grandfather introduced me to beekeeping on his farm. Bees work together, they strive for unity, and like the way they operate as one, it was fascinating always. I felt how bees were helping me a lot, and then I could help others who were struggling and going through the same. I started offering free beekeeping workshops to refugees. The war started in Syria. The situation was very difficult. We left everything. When I came to UK, I feel homesick. To be honest, this is the first time I feel happy after I left Syria 10 years ago. I was introduced to the coordinator at the Red Cross who was interested in the project.
A lot of young people that we work with, they came here by themselves. Most of them are under 18. And they've been through lots of horrible, traumatic experiences back in their country, but also throughout the journey, and suffer from all kind of post-traumatic stress disorder. A big thing is to provide a safe space for young people to connect with other people who had been through the same thing. I think it's a really brilliant initiative.
Refugees are still going through a lot. However, if we get stuck in that mentality, we will achieve nothing, and this is not how I was raised. What I want to achieve is eventually a network of trained refugees who are using beekeeping either as therapy or as a source of income. We hope people keep supporting the project.
Thanks so much for watching the show. Good night, my friends. Good night!